Lars Grundhofer from DLR, and he's going to talk to us about phase estimation for navigation purposes in maritime environments. It's a maritime topic, but it's like many maritime topics, very closely related to radio, and it's about position finding. I'm very curious what this talk is about, because that's my professional background anyway. Okay, welcome on the stage.
Yeah. Thank you. I want to present some different application for software-defined radio, because we use software-defined radio for phase estimation in the end. Let's start with a short table of contexts. I will start with an introduction, what we already do. And then we will continue with some theory about phase estimation. Then I will show some real-world measurement, like Evigotem does. And in the end, I will conclude my talk. So in the maritime navigation, the main goal is the collision avoidance of ships, because at least for electrical navigation aids. And so there is a need for reliant PNT. This means positioning, navigation, and timing. Maybe very much hams now. Timing is an issue somehow. Nowadays, it depends on GNSS. This means Galileo, GPS, GLONASS, stuff like this. The problem is, this does not work all over the ocean very well. So GNSS is prone to spoofing and jamming, stuff like this. And so there is a need for a backup system. And last time, there was the LORAN C system, a very old system for navigation aid. But this is nowadays shut down. So this was working in the 100 kilohertz range. And so the idea comes up to use other services. So this is called air mode. We want to have a terrestrial navigation system and use existing signals. So we want to use the signal of opportunities. For the maritime environment, that would be the IALA beacon. This is a differential GPS service for ships in the 300 kilohertz range, so very near to ham bands and the non-directional beacon of airplanes. And another one would be the automatic identification system, AIS, where the ships communicate with each other. I will concentrate on the IALA beacon, and later I will show why. But the basic problem is to get a pseudo-range estimation. So we have transmitter, all are time synchronized with each other, and from our received signal, we want to get the information where we are. So we need to estimate these blue circles by the time of arrival, and this we can do with bit timing, or we can estimate the phase. And we're going the way to estimate the phase, and yes, then we would continue why I want to use the IALA beacon service. The RES are very range limited, so the RES works in the megahertz range, so it's limited to the line of sight around 80 kilometers. With the IALA beacon, we can get a range around 300 kilometers because it's propagated as ground wave. And we also have a good station network in the Baltic Sea. This is our main region where we want to use it in the beginning. So you see we are covered very well in the Baltic Sea. So when it gets blues, we get less than three stations. That's not enough for positioning. But the main area is very good, well covered. Within my project I'm working in, the Air Mode Baltic project, the EU project, we develop a testbed starting 2020. So when you then look at this area, turn your radio on, you may see a kind of different signal, which will I present on the next slide. So the IALA beacon signal for now, sending is information at minimum shift gear, shortly MSK. This is a quite odd phase shift keying, and this turns out is not enough to get positioning. So the main idea is to introduce two CV signals beside the main carrier, exactly 225 hertz, because there's the zero crossing of the MSK modulation in the spectrum. For now, there is a small test bed with the station Helgoland in Seven, where you can see the signal. This is actually the spectrum of Seven. You see this, this is a real spectrum because the continuous wave amplitudes are different in height. Yeah, so we switch on to theory because this is a nice one in software-defined radio. You can always start with simulation. The MSK signal is a phase shift keying, and the information is stored in the phase shifting during one bit time. You see, I covered here the signal, the sinus. It depends on the frequency, and during the bit time, depending on the bit sent, it's a 1 or a minus 1, the frequency is shifted a bit. And overall, this is phase continuous. This is very interesting. So we have to introduce this phi k. This is called the memory of the MSK. The problem is for the positioning solving, this means I have this parameter I don't know now. And so we get ambiguities of 250 meters, which correspond to p half phase. So this is quite a problem for the MSK signal. This is why they later on introduced the continuous wave signal. So, but how I want to estimate the phase of MSK signal? Yeah, it's very easy. I use the Hilbert transform. I get real sampled values from the analog digital converter, and then I want to have an analytic signal, so a complex representation with amplitude and phase. And in frequency domain, this is really easy because the real valued signal have negative and positive frequency components. I multiply the signal function and get a all real spectrum. When I do EFT, I end up with a called analytic signal, which is phase and amplitude information. The nice thing on this, I can make it as filter, so it's real-time capable, which is good for positioning. When a ship is moving, I want somehow get a real-time function. So this is how my simulated signal looks like. I have the CV on the side, in the middle is the MSK, and now I want to estimate the phase of the MSK. The problem is, when I use the whole signal, I would estimate every phase somewhere in the signal. So I have to add a very narrow filter only with the MSK information and filter out the CV information. So when I do this, I end up like a plot like this. I remove the continuous phase of the carrier and apply the Hilbert transform on the signal. The problem is when I have the combined signal of MSK and continuous wave, I get the swivels. And this is due to, such a narrow filter is not so easy to implement and, not possible in the end. So we have to get another solution than just filter the CV signals out and estimate the phase on the MSK. But anyways, we want to use the continuous wave signals, so we want to estimate the continuous wave signals, which we then in the end can neglect. So the CV signal is a bit more mathematical complex to estimate. There are three parameters we want to estimate: amplitude, phase, and frequency. The frequency is known, so we only get with amplitude and phase. And in the literature, you can look up, there's a maximum likelihood estimation. This means basically, I tested every parameter with my likelihood function, this which is DL, and then I have to find a function which described the maximum for every case. So, for this maximum likelihood estimation, this is for the amplitude, BI, the magnitude of our sampled signal, and for the phase, it's the argument of our sampled signal. Yes. So remember in which frequency band we are, 300 kilohertz, so we have ambiguities due to the frequency from 1 kilometers. And another trick is we have two continuous waves. So we can multiply it. We have then a signal of 450 hertz, can estimate the phase again, and come up with ambiguities every 600 kilometers. With this, we have no ambiguities in our service range. this is quite nice in the end. So I now estimate the stuff and subtract it from my simulated signal. You see, this works in simulation quite well. No stuff is left over. And when I do the Hilbert transform again, I just have the slight rounds due to the filter, but everything else looks good now in simulation. So I have now to get to the software-defined radio part. And this is our test setup. We have an Eto software-defined radio, which is synchronized with an external GPS clock. This is a rubidium frequency standard, which is GPS stabilized. So it gets the time from the GPS time. And when the GPS knocks out, we can use the rubidium standard. So we have a PPS signal for the time and a 10 megahertz reference signal for the phase. It's just an analog digital converter, at least how we use it, and send the data to the PC where they are stored. So for now, we do everything in post-processing, which is quite nice. So this is my testing site in our labor. You see the Glocks, just the quite big cases. On top of it, there's the software-defined radio. And then we have the two screens, which belongs to two different computers. And here I'm testing decoding and encoding RTCM. This is where the information of the MSK are stored. Or, other speaking, the DLR beacon sent this message in the standard RTCM2. Yes, here I'm also testing synchronization. This works everything quite well. And then I have to go outside. We have this quite nice loop antenna, which two Dolphy amplifier stages. And in the end, you see back there some solar cells on the roof. And when I plot the spectrum, I should see three IALA beacon stations at 285 Helgoland on 303.5 Zeven and at 308 Großmoordorf. But you see Großmoordorf is somewhere in noise floor, and this noise floor is depend on solar cells you see then on the picture back. And this is for us a great problem because we get a lot of noise, like from the non-directional beacon of the airplane, they are exactly in the same frequency range, from solar cells obviously, and some other faulty device, I don't know now which everything goes on. So, but in the end, I can do the estimation on the station 7. You see, this was the high peak. We were somewhere in the Elbe-Weser triangle. And yes, I get as 100 megas, 1 mega sample rate, and always calculate a bunch of 1 second. So I do for 1 second my calculation and make a point in the plot. In the end, it looks like this, very noisy, but the standard deviation is with 7.29 meters, not so bad. And when you think there's somewhere like a sine wave on the noise, when I make the same with the beat frequency, remember I calculate the 2 CV sequence, get a very low frequency with 450 hertz, I have a quite larger standard deviation, which corresponds to 8 kilometers. This is quite bad for positioning. So I can say, oh, on 8 kilometers, I'm here. That's not so useful. Again, I see the same sinus wave within the signal. And of course, I do the same with the MSK. And there we have a different kind of stuff. What I've done for the distance estimation with the MSK, I have the demodulated, no, not demodulated, but the phase of the MSK signal and generate a perfectly synchronized signal and then just measure the difference between the phases. Again for 1 second and plot it again. And now you see this huge disturbances every 130 seconds. This is, I don't know where this happens. I think we have a slightly frequency drift in our measurement. I make some testing in the laboratory that seems to be like this, but we have to have a further look in it. But actually, the noise is not so bad for this estimation because we are here somewhere of 49 meters noise, which only goes to 0.1 rad per p. This is not so much in terms of phase. Yeah. So now we come to my conclusion. I've shown some phase estimation, obviously, and we designed our own SDR IALA beacon receiver within this topic you may mentioned. We have a lot of problem with EMI interference in the signal level and large disturbance in the estimation of the phase. This is one of our testing sites on a ship from the Polish Maritime University. So we had some measurements all over the Baltic Sea. And my next steps are find reason for the disturbance, have further investigation of the phase estimation. And another thing is, like in GPS, there's this additional secondary factor. Maybe we can introduce something like this in the system. And maybe you are now interesting in the system and want to have a look in the signal when it's come up until 2020. Thank you.
Yeah, that's really interesting. Have you seen the talk of what's his name? We've had a talk, what was it, last year, 2 years ago, about position finding of transmitters. That's actually something very similar. It's just the inverse way. It's also about comparing two signals. It's not the kind of maximum likelihood comparison. It's a cross correlation. What the guy was doing.
I think transmission finding is something different than what we do here for positioning. So it's somehow the other way around, but we estimate just the range from the transmitter, not the direction of the transmitter. The direction estimation is done, for example, in the Lorentz Sea system. There they have this two loops switched each other 90 degrees, and then they have a third antenna for the direction. So they have this bearing calculation from this.
Yeah, it was Stefan Scholl, Delta Charlie 9, Sierra Tango. And we have the talk here in the YouTube channel. It's called Introduction and Experiments on Transmitter Localization. Of course, you know the transmitter positions. That's your asset in that scenario, but you don't know your own position, and you want to find your own position on the boat. That's just the other way around. So very, very interesting also. Any questions from your side?
So the frequency recovery, it is done right now in your test system using like external GPS clocks, which is obviously like the right thing to start with. So do you plan to later on convert that to like a PLL locking onto the CW carriers? Or I mean, that's kind of a problem because you delete the information and that.
So in the end, we want to have a system used by manufacturers. So obviously the rubidium standard would be too expensive. And so we need time synchronization within the system, but when there are more stations, this is not so much the problem anymore. With four stations, I can estimate the clock offset and then make something like time difference of arrival to get a positioning.
Okay, cool.
Okay, any more questions? No sailors around here? No sailors, really, no. It's surprising. We have such a big lake here and there are no sailors around here. That's a cool technology, by the way. Okay, then. Thank you very much, Lars.